Alright, I'm going to say shalom to everyone. Today's lesson should be a very easy lesson. First and foremost, thank the Most High for the Sabbath, approaching Sabbath day. So that's sundown on a so-called Friday night. So you're going into the new day based on when the sun goes down. But I wanted to kind of like bring this up to speed in regards to a lot of debates, it seemed like, based on was Christ crucified on a cross or on a tree. Now, this debate is so futile to the point where I thought I wasn't going to entertain this, but since there were some misconstruing of scriptures and some people has been, you know, kind of like misinterpreting scriptures, I thought I would just go into it. Now, first, we got to understand what a crucifixion is. That's capital punishment, a Roman capital punishment style type death. What they use is, and I'm just going to show in scriptures, they use an actual cross. The cross is two pieces of wood as a formation of a T. Some people say, well, no, he died on a tree. Well, even where you put it, it's almost like, it's so futile. I'm going to show you how futile this is. If somebody got a Jetta, you know, which is a car, you know what a Jetta is. It's a car. But sometimes if you're speaking to someone, you don't always have to say exactly what type of car you got. So we understand if some points of scripture, when you see tree, just remember that it's actually talking about a crucifixion. Christ was crucified on a cross. He was crucified on a tree. Either or, the way you say it, it depends on where you at in scripture. If you're having a conversation to someone and they already have explained to you, for an example, what type of car they got, and if it's a Jetta, a Honda, or whatever, you don't have to always go on and say, hey, how's your Honda Accord LX is doing? Nah, you just go, hey, how your car is doing. So that's what it is. Tree just represent he died on a cross. And I'll show you exactly what the scriptures are talking about. I mean, it's not something that we should just harp on to the point where you're almost like debating over if it was a tree or a cross. I mean, let me just put this out here, okay? And I'm going to just make this clear. Let's go to Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. All right. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. And it says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. In the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. So what we realize is, once you believe in the Most High Son, you're going to lay down your life for him. You may have to do that literally, as he did. But this, in terms, usually about, I would say, 75% to 100%, you will have to lay down your flesh. That's crucifixion. That's punishment for us to do that. That's why it says in Romans 8:6, for to be carnally minded is death. So your carnal mind is death to the spiritual. So what happens is it's punishment to lay down your sins and your habits and all that. So that's what it is. It's you're laying down. It's painful. So it represents Christ, because he had to lay down his life literally, physically. He went to a cross or a tree. Okay, I'll break it down. Let's go to Matthew chapter 27, verse 35. Matthew 27 and 35, and it says, and they crucified him and parted his garment, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet. So I'm going to go into what the prophet said. They parted my garment among them, and upon my vesture did cast lots. So let's go to Psalms chapter 22, verse 18. All right, sometimes when you read the Psalms of David, a lot of his Psalms, he gets poetic and prophetic intuition from the Most High. All right, let's go to Psalms chapter 22, verse 18. They part my garment among them and cast lots upon my vesture. Now, this is in the Old Testament talking about Christ. All right, Let's go to Matthew chapter 28, verse 5. Now, what I'm showing you is the scriptures based on crucified. Now, again, crucifixion based on Roman capital punishment is a cross. You can do the research right now. They take two dead trees, which is wood now. They take two pieces of wood, cross them together, and nail you right here. Not in the hands, because it'll rip through, okay? But it more than likely is in this area. That's why most people, when they want to kill themselves, they cut the wrist, because you bleed quicker there. So they did it. Boom, they put the nails here, because you have a mandible bone right in that area. And those two, it can actually hold you up that in those spots. All right, there's research on that. All right, so let's go to Matthew chapter 28, verse 5. And the angel answered and said unto them, unto the woman, fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Christ, which was crucified. So I'm just reading excerpts of scripture that shows crucifixion. He was crucified. So they were looking for him. That means he died, because I heard some information on a video, which is very unlearned statement about there's no evidence or there's no scriptures that talk about Christ dying on a cross, or Christ was actually, he died basically on a cross. And I'm going to show you exactly what scriptures that was being missed, just because the people don't see the word cross. The thing is, when you read the Old Testament, especially when you go to Isaiah 53, certain parts, like I just read in Psalms, you're not going to see a cross. Okay, but that's a rightly divided truth. Eventually, during the transliterations and different times of scripture being compiled, you're going to see that the Romans took over that type of capital punishment. Now our people would hang people on trees as well, but it wasn't that type of Roman type of capital punishment. It was almost the way you would say how we were hung on trees by our neck. That's what would happen. I'll do a full lesson on that one day. All right, let's go to Luke chapter 24, verse 7. Luke 24 and 7, it says, saying the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men. So if you're going to be delivered in the hands of sinful men, you're going to be killed and slaughtered on those sinful men customs of how they do capital punishment. All right, that's just the way it goes. Sinful men, and be crucified, and the third day rise again. So after the third day, he's going to rise again. So we understand that Christ died for our sins. See, that's the big issue. We understand that he died. The problem is what people and what Satan is laughing in the corner. He's probably laughing his behind off. You get in disputations because of how he did die. Like, man, look, he died for your sins. He rose again the third day. He was crucified. I don't care if you call it a tree. I don't care if you call it a cross. But I know for a fact it was a cross. When I say facts, it's because once you go into Roman history, they show crucifixions. And I'm going to get into a scripture where it talks about Golgotha in Rome. Not in Rome, but in the areas outside of Jerusalem, which is Calvary. That's what they would do. They would put you behind, stake some wood in the ground, and put you behind on a tree and nail you on a cross. They would cross both, because you can't breathe like this for so long. Okay? So let's go to Luke 24, verse 20. Luke 24, verse 20. And how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death. To death. So we understand that Christ died, right? To death. And have crucified him. All right? Let's go to Galatians chapter 5, verse 24. Now, again, I'm reading excerpts of scriptures to show crucifixion, how he was, like I say, that's capital punishment. Galatians 5, verse 24.
And this is a big scripture, because some people don't know that they can be like Christ. And any person that in the world that lay down their sins and take up their cross as he did, you are considered like a Christ. This is what this scripture is saying. This is a big scripture, so I want y'all to pay attention. Galatians 5, verse 24. And they that are Christ's. You see that? That parenthesis there? I mean, I forgot what that's called, but y'all know what I'm talking about. Have crucified the flesh with the affection and lust. You see that?
and they that are Christ have crucified the flesh. So Christ did it physically, right? So he did that physically. Now we have to do it on physically, but not to the point where somebody's going to put us on the cross. But it's, I'm going to tell you, it's the flesh war against the spirit. So it's still torture. It's still torture. So, I mean, I can give a small example today. Of course, you know how, you know, men are, how we are, how our eyes can wander. And I'm on a bus, and even though the young lady was covered, but she was extremely attractive. So I turned my head. I don't need to be looking and lusting. So that's what it's a war. So you look and people say, well, I can look. Yeah, I can do this. I can do that. But yeah, y'all, you having issues at home with your wife and you wonder why, because you allowed your eyes to wander. Anytime something wander off and you looking, I'm not trying to change the whole topic of this lesson, but eventually you allow certain spirits to test you. They're not in you yet, but they'll come around you more. Just, okay, yeah, he been looking, so let's kind of edge him on to do more. But just put some other people around him, and eventually you're going to fall into something that you shouldn't be dealing with. So that's why the Most High says, flee from fornication. Some people say, well, man, you can look, but the scriptures say in Matthew 5, gouge your eye out. It's better to go into the kingdom of heaven with a member missing, opposed to the whole body going to hell. So you're supposed to turn and not look and pay attention. Just leave, you know what I'm saying? So I just wanted to show an example of how the flesh is needs to be crucified, all right? Let's go to Luke chapter 23, verse 33. Luke chapter 23, verse 33. And it says, and when they were come to the place which is called Calvary, which is, and I want to make this clear, Calvary is outside of Jerusalem gates, the outside of the borders, now it's in a different jurisdiction, which is called Golgotha. And you link Golgotha, it's talking about skulls, which represents death. Okay? And in that particular area, the customs is you hang people on crosses. That's what the Romans would do. You're talking about Romans. You're talking about Europeans. Not all. Like I said, not all Europeans are bad. But you're talking about this seed here, the Romans? These people ain't play with you. All right? Which is called Calvary, Golgotha, or skulls. There they crucified him. So they crucified him, and the malefactors, one of the right hand and the other on the left. So it was two malefactors there. This is in scripture. It's talking about the two crooks on that was on one side and on the other side of Christ. All right. So let's go to and I'm going to go back to some scriptures on that, based on the word cross. All right. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 13, verse 12. It says, wherefore, Yeshua, I'll just say Jesus for right now, so for those that may be new to the channel. Wherefore, Jesus also that might sanctify the people with his own blood, he had that pure, perfect blood, right? Suffered without gate. So when you see suffered without gate, it's actually talking about Calvary. Because he was outside of the gates of Jerusalem. All right. So that's the scripture that precepts Luke chapter 23, verse 33. All right. So let's go to the scriptures used to discredit the cross. All right. I'm going to go through these five. I think it's really four scriptures. What I heard on a video is about five scriptures that has the word tree there. But yet, I'm going to go through these five scriptures for the benefit of the doubt. You see? Because I'm glad people are in the book. That's a good thing. But I'm going to shut this debate, this small futile debate down, because I'm going to go through about 27 scriptures with the word cross in it in the New Testament. And you know what? I'm just going to read the scriptures. From here on out, I may interpret some that I think people may have issues with, but I'm just going to read the scriptures. This is going to be an easy lesson, okay? Real easy to pay. Y'all got a pen and paper? All you got to do is write down these scriptures. All right, let's go to Acts chapter 5, verse 30. So these are the scriptures that they use to discredit the cross. Now, mind you, I've went to Luke, Matthews, Galatians. We talk about crucified or crucifixion. That's a capital punishment. They don't understand the customs or the way they deal with capital punishment in Rome. The Romans will put you on a cross. Okay? It would take two logs or whatever you want to call it, tee them up, and put your behind on it. All right, let's go to Acts 5 and 30. And it says, the God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom ye slew, and hang on a tree. So you're thinking that he was just hang, I mean, they just found some regular tree and just put him there. And tree here is representing the cross, and I'll show you. So you just hang on. Don't click the red X to the right yet. Let's go to Acts 10, verse 39. Acts 10, 39. And it says, and we are witnesses of all things which he did both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they slew and hanged on a tree. So you got two verses. Let me make sure I did this right. I don't want to, because somebody says, we got five verses. All right, so that's another verse talking about a tree. Let's go to Galatians chapter 3, verse 13. Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law. So this does not say that you don't have to follow the law anymore. Being made a curse for us. So he is the propitiation for our sins. So based on this, there's no more sacrifice in the lamb anymore. But that doesn't exclude the dietary law. All right, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. And it's talking about the law of sacrifice. Being made a curse for us, for it is written, curse is every one that hangeth on a tree. So yes, the children of Israel were hung on trees during slavery. That's what that's talking about. Okay. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24. This is the other scripture that said that tries to discredit the cross. And mind you, we understand that Christ still died for your sins and he still was crucified, right? Remember, I went through Galatians in the first part of this showing crucified. So you have to read sometimes just the whole chapter to get the full understanding, but this is real easy. But some people just try to nitpick on certain things just to try to make a video or something to get notoriety or something. I don't understand. Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree. Okay, so he was on the tree, right? That we being dead to sin should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes we are healed. So this links to Isaiah chapter 53. And it says, and it goes into that scripture, it goes to those verses when it talks about by his stripes we are healed. The thing about that is, the big issue is these five or four scriptures, people are misconstruing, not understanding what tree is. If you take two pieces of wood, what type of wood is it? It has to come from a tree. Oak, populus, which is a Babylonicus, which links to what is that tree called? The weeping willow. Who knows what trees they were using to cut into a cross? So of course it's a tree. That's common sense. Of course, if you got a car, but what kind of car is it? Oh, it's a Jetta, it's a Honda, it's a Toyota. So we established that yet already. So now if I talk to you again, that means we understand each other based on our conversation prior. You see what I'm saying? So that's why when you see tree here, it's certain, you're talking about, we in Galatians, Acts. It was already established. Let me go back to, so this can be very clear. All right. You got to realize something. You're reading in Acts. So understand this, that Christ died and rose again in Luke. Okay. He's going to get crucified in Galatians 5, verse 24. He's going to get crucified in Luke 24 and 20, Matthew 28 and 5. Matthew 27:35, even in Psalms, it was prophesied for him to be crucified in Psalms 22 verse 18. So you're looking at scriptures in the wrong context. When you say, well, was it a tree or was it a cross? Based on what we're reading, we understand that they already understood what a cross is made out of. So they're just kind of like short-terming it to say hung on a tree. That's what it's talking about based on what Christ, what it's talking about Christ in reference to Christ. All right, real easy, because it's already been established. Now let's go to Matthew chapter 10 verse 38. Now these are the scriptures that I'm just going to read, and there's about 25 of them based on the word cross in it. All right, very easy. Matthew 10 verse 38. So people want to discredit the cross, so I guess all these scriptures are injections. No. We're back in Matthew's, so we can understand what tree that it's being talked about in Acts. In Acts. Let me get it. Make sure this is clear. In Acts chapter 5, verse 30. In Acts chapter 10, verse 39. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24. Galatians 3, verse 13. So those particular scriptures except Galatians 3 verse 13, it is actually talking about what was already established, a crucifixion based on Christ being put on a cross. Remember, those scriptures that I'm about to get into are before Acts and all the other New Testament scriptures. So let's go to Matthew 10 verse 38. And he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. So if you don't tell your flesh to leave you alone and you don't kill it, not physically but spiritually, and if somebody come to you and be like, hey man, I want you to follow this God right here, or I'm gonna crucify you, you better take that crucifixion, period. So you have to lay down your flesh. Laying down your flesh is punishment for this body. So it's like a cross. It's a cross. See, cross here represent, in a subliminal or metaphorical term, or if you want to say esoteric, let me draw this. I didn't want to go this route, but I'll just show you. Some people may balk on this, but I have to show it. You know, y'all know how I teach. I'm an analytic man. So you have a cross here, right? It represents more than just, it's symbology to the point where you can understand it spiritually. That's why when you read, and he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me, there's a reason behind cross. Like when you say crossroads. So what happens is if you can see this, this is symbol. This is the earth. This line here. This is the earth, which connects to the ground, which represent what Christ did. He went and took the keys and the sting out of death. Okay? This represents the head, which represents your spirit, where it dwells. It dwells above the plane of the earth. All right, so let me just write this down. I didn't want to get into this because some people may balk on this, but you got to understand the spirituality of words, cross right there in that particular scripture. So you have the earth here. I'm just writing this earth, and then below that you have, well, you know, dirt and things of that nature, and then it links to, you know, hell or Hades. I'll just put Hades there for the sake of viewers. Hades. And don't laugh at my handwriting, because I'm writing this stuff all messed up. Earth. And then you have what you would call heaven. So this is what the cross represents. Earth. You with dirt or whatever, the soil, the land, and then you have Hades, where everyone goes to rest. That's a big lesson. I may go into that one day. I have so much on my table. So now you have this is earth, where we at. So once you die to your sins, you become like the heavenlies, the heavenly Father himself. That's one way to look at it, based on the spirituality of the word cross. So it's almost like a crossroad. All right, but that's why they turn it upside down in satanic cults, because they didn't like the fact that happened, to break through to life again, for Satan didn't like that. All right, so let me not get too caught up in certain things. Let's go to Matthew chapter 16, verse 24. Matthew 16, verse 24. Then said Christ unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. This is the lawgiver between Christ's footsteps. When you read in Genesis chapter 49, when it talks about the tribe of Judah. Then said Christ unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. So you're supposed to take up your cross. That's tough. I'm not going to sit up here and say it's easy. You're talking about a sinful body, pickled and sauteed in being evil, and you're telling a person to come away from that. Yes, that's why it says take up your cross. It's painful. All right? So, and anybody say, nah, it's easy. Nah. No, the burden that Christ took was easy. Our burden is, which means we don't have to go on a cross. So certain scriptures you see about Christ, he said, my burden is light. Yes, his, for us to follow his footsteps based on the spiritual part of it. But he had to actually go through the physical part. Let's go to Matthew 27, verse 32. And I'm just going to read, matter of fact, 27, verse 40. Matthew 27 and 40. And it says, and saying thou that destroyeth the temple and buildeth it in 3 days, save thyself. If thou be the Son of God, come down from the cross. So they were tempting the Most High Son to come down off the cross. We understand that story. So like I said, this is the excerpt of scripture to show it says come down from the cross. Okay? Matthew 27, verse 42. He saved others, himself he cannot save. So he saved everybody else or others, but he can't save himself. This is another way that they're trying to tempt the Most High Son. If he be the king of Israel, let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe him. Mark 8, verse 34. Now, I think I've already broke through those five scriptures that people didn't understand, but hopefully they do understand it when you go into Acts and all that. See, we got to understand that the cross roads was already established through Christ. That's why I showed that little small, you know, it wasn't too elaborate how what that those two pieces of wood represent. All right. Mark 8, verse 34. And when he had called the people unto him with his disciples, also he said unto them, whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. So he's telling you again. All right. Let's go to Mark chapter 10, verse 21. Then Christ, beholding him, loved him and said unto him, one thing thou lackest, go thy way. Now this is talking about, to give you an overview, it's talking about the rich boy that had a rack of money. And he was saying, go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast, and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come take up the cross and follow me. So he had to become as a base person as Christ. Because you know Christ is, he come from the heavenlies. They got everything up there. Gold. I mean, you're talking about when you read in Revelations, the whole street is made out of gold. The sun won't even have to shine anymore. So you're talking about somebody coming here in the sinful flesh for us, becoming base. So people don't understand, to be like Christ, you should be able to say, take $1 million and throw it in the ocean and follow him. Seriously, believe that. If you can't do it, that means you're just like this rich boy, because this man left. He said, Christ, if you read the whole story, Christ said it's best, it's easy for a man to walk through a camel's eye than a rich man being saved. Because you have certain, you know, areas in Jerusalem back when we were there, certain when it says eye of a needle, this very narrow gap. So if you got a camel, you would have to unload your camel first, and then the camel can go through. So it's easier for a camel to go through an eye of a needle. That's what it meant. I'm paraphrasing it wrong. It's easy for a camel to go through an eye of a needle, opposed to a rich man being saved. So that's what that scripture, this, it goes into that in Matthew chapter 10, verse 21. All right, let's go to Mark chapter 15, verse 30. Mark 15, verse 30, and it says, save thyself and come down from the cross. So this is they're tempting Christ on the cross again, on the cross. So these are particular scriptures, excerpts. We see that it's talking about Christ being on a cross. Okay, Mark 15, verse 32. Let Christ, the King of Israel, descend down from the cross. From the cross, right? That we may see and believe, and they that were crucified with him reviled him. Let's go to Luke chapter 9, verse 23. So I done read about, 10 scriptures already. Luke chapter 9, verse 23. And he said to them, all, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily, continuously. That means there's something that you got to do all the time. This is not to say that you can fall in sin and then, this is not saying that you can fall in sin every day. No, this means if you take up your cross daily, you ain't falling into sin. Take up your cross daily and follow me. Luke 14, verse 27. Luke 14, verse 27, it says, and whosoever doeth not bear his cross, bear something is a burden, man. Bear his cross and come after me, cannot be my disciple. You cannot be the Most High Son's disciple if you're not bearing up your cross, period. Let's go to Luke 23, verse 27. And as they led him away, they laid hold upon one Simeon, a Cyrenian, coming out of the country, and on him they laid the cross, that he might bear it after Christ. Now this is not one of the disciples. This is another man named Simeon. That's why it says a Cyrenian. Cyrenian. So it was a different person of Simeon. So it wasn't one of the 12 disciples. And it says country. And on him they laid the cross. So you know how they show the passion of Christ and all that, when it shows that the cross was, you know, he was helping him because Christ was getting weary. So he looked in his eyes and he knew that he was the Son of the Most High. All right, let's go to John chapter 19, verse 17. And it says, and he bearing his cross. So Christ actually did this physically. So that's why he tell us, my burden is light. Because once we follow his footsteps, we ain't going to have to be taking no heavy cross and blood coming out of our hands and all that. We don't have to go through that physically. If you do, which is a very probably rare thing, you better take that cross. Don't sell out like a Judas Iscariot, and how even Peter had to deny Christ 3 times to shake his faith, even though he loved him, but his faith was shaken. He said, you here among me, but you going to deny me 3 times. All right, let's go to, I'm going to read the rest of John chapter 19, verse 17. It says, and he bearing his cross went forth into a place called the place of a skull. That's why I wanted to show when I said earlier. And it says, which is called in Hebrew, Golgotha, which is Calvary in the Greek linguistics or dialect. So when you see scriptures, you got to understand Old Quick is English. Tree and cross is just about synonymous. So I don't know why people are getting into these futile debates on if it was a tree or if it was a cross or that. That's futile. It's mundane. It's to the point where it's too small to be trying to get into a debate. And it's diminutive. You're talking about something to the magnitude of a man dying for your sins, and people arguing about how he died. Was it a cross or a tree? I was talking to a sister today. We argue over how many times we can come up with 4. 5 minus 1 is 4. 2 plus 2 is 4. You know, 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 is 4, and all that. We get caught up in the same. All right, man. Let's go to John. Let's go to John chapter 19, verse 19. That's how I know we're the children of Israel. We fight over silly stuff, man. John chapter 19, verse 19. And Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross. The cross. The cross. And the writings was, I'm going to put, just say Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Yeshua of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. But he put this on a cross. That's a Roman crucifix, people. That's how Romans kill people. John chapter 19, verse 25. Remember, he was given up to the Romans based on his own disciple. John 19, verse 25. And it says, now there stood by the cross. So somebody is standing by a cross. Even though we know that wood is made out of trees. So you're going to see tree in the Old, in the New Testament. I mean, in Galatians and Ephesians and things of that nature. But even in Galatians and Ephesians and 1 Corinthians, you're going to, and I'm going to read those scriptures, you're going to see cross there too. So which one is it? How can you can't cherry pick on some type of doctrine? I don't know. It must be some type of doctrine going around saying that it wasn't a cross. It was a tree. Okay. It wasn't a Jetta, but it was a Volkswagen. I mean, it's still... All right, let me stop. John chapter 19, verse 25. Oh, man, boy. John chapter 19, verse 25. Now there stood by the cross. There's somebody standing by the cross of Yeshua, his mother, and his mother's sisters, Mary, the wife of Cleophas, and Mary Magdalene. So they were standing by a tree. If you want to use that, but what type of formation was the tree cut in? A cross type formation. John chapter 19, verse 31. All right, John 19, verse 31. The Jews therefore, because it was the preparation that the body should not remain upon the cross. So upon the cross on the Sabbath day. For the Sabbath day was in high day, besought Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect. Now, some people would get into this and say, see, he didn't send me to baptize, but not understanding that every person is not sent to baptize. That doesn't mean that it is something that you don't supposed to get, which is baptism. So, like I said, I do another lesson on baptism and go into some more excerpts of scriptures to make that very clear. But let me finish this, because I think those five scriptures should be clear now that somebody brought out all these five scriptures that talked about the tree. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. So if you're going to teach people about how Christ died for your sins, to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of the Most High. You're saved based on taking up your cross daily. Not because you got baptized. Not because you go to a church or you got a three-piece suit on or you follow Easter Sunday. No, it's not talking. It's talking about following the scriptures as it is written on a daily basis. Taking up your cross daily. Then you're considered saved. Okay, daily. Let's go to Galatians chapter 5, verse 11. Because some people say, well, once I speak in tongues, or once I get baptized, or once I read this scripture, or once I read that, or once I do this, and I'm saved now. There's no turning back because I believe in Jesus. But what is the what in believing in Yeshua, or what people call him today, Jesus, what does that consist of? Maybe I'll do a lesson on that one day. All right, let's go to Galatians chapter 5, verse 11. Galatians 5 and 11. But I think these particular excerpts of scripture show you what believing in Christ is. It's something that you have to do daily, not commit sins on purpose. Okay? Galatians 5 and 11. And I, brethren, if I yet preach circumcision, why do I yet suffer persecution? Then is the offense the cross ceased? Because basically, if you're dealing with circumcision, that's a good thing to do, as the custom of the Hebrews would do. But that can offend someone that believe in Christ and that he died for his sins. Because if you're just following the law and that's it without Christ, then that's offensive based on what Christ did for you. That's offensive. All right. So let's go to Galatians chapter 6, verse 12. Galatians 6, verse 12. These are excerpts of scriptures talking about cross. So I didn't cover about 20 of them. As many as desire to make a fair show in the flesh, they constrain you to be circumcised, only lest they should suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. We're talking about cross again. So what Paul is fighting here, you have people in certain areas, Galatians, he's teaching people in certain parts. So he's in this area, and you know, you have our people all the time dealing with the laws, and that's it. So he's going around recruiting, just like Christ taught all the disciples to tell them the God, you know, teach them the gospel. The kingdom of the Most High is at hand. And then repent, get baptized, every one of you, in the name of Yeshua. That's Acts 2, verse 38. So he's going around teaching that, and people coming against him talking about, well, you got to be circumcised, you got to get this done, you got to do this. So that's what Paul is fighting. Let's go to Galatians 6, and we're going to go to the 14th verse. And it says, but God forbid that I should glory, save the cross of our Lord, Yeshua Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. Basically, he took the death, the sting out of death, so we can have another chance. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 16. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 16. There's another scripture that I just read that's actually talking about cross. And we're in Galatians. I didn't read three scriptures in Galatians alone. Now, some people will say, well, you know, since you want to go past, you know, Matthew's, because you go through Acts and you just see tree a few times. But I didn't read Corinthians 1 and 18, Galatians 5 and 11. Galatians 6, verse 12 and verse 14. Ephesians 2, verse 16. So those are five scriptures right there. Let's go to Philippians chapter 2, verse 8. So this is the way you understand scripture. You can't just take a few scriptures that got tree in it and run with it. Understand what that tree is talking about. It's actually talking about a tree that's been staked in the ground in a cross formation. That's the way Roman punishment, capital punishment, is dealt with. Let's go to Philippians chapter 2, verse 8, and it says, and being found in fashion as a man, so he was found fashioned as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. So it shows you, this is esoteric, okay, I'm gonna use that term, metaphorical, subliminal, got a deeper meaning when it says, and being found in fashion as a man, which means he was from the beginning. He was from the beginning. Let me just show that. And I know people probably heard this, you know, read before. So let's go to John chapter 1. Real easy, right? So he comes from the heavenly. That's what the cross represents, the part that's here, and you know, you got the earth here. Then down, he had to go down in the depths for 3 days and three nights. That's what the cross represents. Right, but see, they are when they was doing capital punishment, they represented it as to do something evil that represents death. But the way Christ did it, he took the keys and the sting of death, and so now we have another chance. All right, let's go to John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. It's actually talking about Christ right there. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him. It's talking about Christ. And without him was not anything made that was made. What happened was God gave Christ the blueprint, the ingenuity. He dealt with all everything you see here. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And I'll show you that Christ created the world. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. Which shows, when it says lighteth every man that cometh into the world, that shows that your spirit was already here. Your the so-called miraculous edge that people kind of balk on, it's clear. Those little stars or whatever, the twinkles that's far away, billions of miles away that you see twinkling, that's where the source of your soul is. Why do they fall then? The angels are out there too. You see them fall, right? What star was seen in the east? Christ's star was seen in the east. He was the brightest of all of us. So that's why you were able to see his star in the east. If you notice, Jerusalem is in the east, that area. Is in the Middle East. And if you, I'll do some more research on a short demonstration, I would say, on how even in regular living, in regular life, if you take a cup of water and you want to create life or like a vibration, it is start in the middle and work its way out. So that's where the Garden of Eden is, in the middle, the so-called Middle East today. That's why so many wars there. Satan took that place over. All right, but he moved out in areas like Pergamos and all that. That's another lesson I'm going off. Let's go to verse 9. That was the true light which light every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him. Who was in the world, and the world was made by him? That's why it says was made, because before he was in the world, he was dealing with the Father. That's why you see scripture that says, let us make man in our image. So he gave Christ the blueprint. Christ just put everything into place. Then the Holy Spirit, that's why people call this place Mother Earth, because it's so beautiful and pretty, and she fashioned everything you see. That's a little bit of meat for some people. Like I said, I'll do a video on that too. That's probably 3 videos I got to put up. So it says he was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. So they didn't understand who actually created this world, or basically the earth, period. All right, so I'm going to go to Philippians chapter 2, verse 8 again, so we can understand that. And being found in fashion was a man. So Christ was found in the fashion of a man. We just read it in John chapter 1. He humbled himself and became obedient unto death. That's why he didn't say anything to nobody. You speak and spit on him or whatever, the crowns of thorns, he didn't say nothing, because he came knowing his purpose. Unto death, even the death of the cross, that crossroads between death, okay, and this life. There was a crossroad, but that symbolizes that those two actual pieces of wood in this formation. See, the thing about that is, whatever you do in the physical, it's within your spirit. Whatever you deal with, if you think some evil thoughts and you write it down, eventually your body physically is going to do something evil. All right. There's a scripture on that. I just can't remember where it is. I think it goes with whatever a man thinketh, that shall he do. Or I'll post that, because I know I'm paraphrasing. But there you have it. I just wanted to show all those actual scriptures based on the cross. So you can't defame something. See, people just take a few, you know, like I said, it was, you know, 4 or 5 scriptures in Acts, all the way, I think, to 1 Peter somewhere. Skit-scatting all over the Bible, not understanding that you can't start way down here in Acts. You got to understand why it was considered a cross, or a tree. It was already established that crucifixion under Roman capital punishment, they use, they stake, if you want to call it, two logs hooked up like this and stake you to that cross. That's the way they did it. That's easy history. You can do some easy regular history and it'll show you that. Roman punishment, they will put you behind on two pieces of wood planked together. So, but they were just short terming it in Acts. They already knew that it was a tree, of course. It's just two pieces of wood. So there you have it. I didn't really want to get in a long lesson on this, but maybe some people needed to know that because it was so many, you know, actual dialogues, you know, not even a dialogue, it was actually debates on this particular subject. There you have it. I'm done. See you all soon. Shalom.